Hello. In this video, we will study so-called compact operators and especially consider the spectral properties. An operator T between two Banach spaces X and Y is defined to be compact if every bounded sequence XK on X has a subsequence XKN such that the sequence of images of XKN converges in Y. Compact operators are quite a nicely behaving class of bounded operators. In particular, the scalar multiples and sums of two compact operators are compact, and the composition of two bounded operators T and S is compact if at least one of the operators is compact. Moreover, if a sequence of compact operators converges to a limit operator T in the operator norm, then the limit T is also a compact operator. The first properties imply that compact operators, in fact, form a subspace of the space of bounded linear operators between X and Y. And the compactness of the limit in the third property also further implies that this is in fact a closed subspace. Compact operators can also be defined on spaces which are not complete, in which case the definition changes a bit, but here we focus on operators between Banach or Hilbert spaces only. We can now take a look at some examples of compact operators. If X and Y are Hilbert spaces and we have two linearly independent sequences of elements zeta k and y k, we can define an operator T with the formula shown here. In each of the terms, we multiply the vector y k with the inner product of the vector x and zeta k. This operator is linear and bounded, and it also turns out to be compact. We can note that for any x, the image Tx is a linear combination of a finite set of vectors yk, and therefore the range of T is finite-dimensional. Because of this property, T is often called a finite-rank operator, and in fact, conversely, any Hilbert space operator with a finite-dimensional range can be expressed in the form shown here. As our second example, we can take a look at the integral operator with a kernel K. We already saw that the operator T defined in this way is linear and bounded, and it is also possible to show that T is in fact compact. There are different ways of doing this, but since we consider T on the Hilbert space L2, it is possible to show that in fact T is a limit in the operator norm of a sequence of operators with finite dimensional ranges, which are all compact due to our first example, and as a limit in the operator topology, T is compact as well. The previous examples are very typical and important examples of compact operators. As an example of an operator which is not compact, we can note that the identity operator on an infinite dimensional linear space is never compact. Indeed, if we consider the definition of compactness, then for the identity operator, the compactness reduces to the condition that every bounded sequence has a convergent subsequence, which holds precisely on finite-dimensional vector spaces. We can now turn to studying the special spectral properties of compact operators on Banach space X. We'll especially see that the spectra of compact operators are relatively close to the familiar spectral properties of matrices, especially in the sense that often most of the spectrum of T consists of isolated eigenvalues, each with a finite number of linearly independent eigenvectors, but there are of course some important differences as well. As our first result, we have that if T is a compact operator and if lambda is a non-zero complex number such that lambda I minus T is not injective, then the dimension of the kernel of lambda I minus T is always finite dimensional. Because the space contains the eigenvectors of T corresponding to lambda, this immediately implies that any non-zero eigenvalue of T can have at most finite number of linearly independent eigenvectors. As we will see in our other results as well, the assumption that lambda is not zero in this result is quite crucial, and it is possible that a compact operator has an infinite number of linearly independent eigenvectors corresponding to the zero eigenvalue. The easiest case where this happens is when T is the zero operator on an infinite dimensional space, in which case every non-zero vector on the space is an eigenvector corresponding to the zero eigenvalue. In the first step of the proof of this result, we can note that if we take an arbitrary x from the kernel of lambda I minus T, then the image Tx is a vector in the same kernel, since it is a scalar multiple of x. Since lambda is not zero, we can now consider the operator 1 over lambda times t. Our previous observation shows that if we restrict this operator onto the kernel of lambda I minus t, then we get an operator which maps this kernel into itself. And therefore we can consider this restriction as an operator on this subspace zeta. But dividing both sides of the eigenvalue equation by lambda, we can note that in fact this restriction of 1 over lambda times t is in fact exactly the identity operator on the space zeta. And in the next step, we can show that since zeta is a closed subspace of X, and since T was assumed to be compact, also the restriction of 1 over lambda times T is a compact operator. But this way, we have shown that the identity operator on zeta is compact, and because of this, our earlier example implies that zeta is necessarily a finite dimensional space. In the previous result, we only considered spectral points of T outside the origin of the complex plane. It turns out that the point zero is always in the spectrum of a compact operator when X is an infinite dimensional space. Indeed, if the operator T would have a bounded inverse, then the identity operator on X could be written as a composition of a compact operator T and a bounded operator T inverse. And therefore, the identity operator would be compact as well. But as we saw before, this can only happen if the space X is finite dimensional. In the lecture notes, we also prove a bit more precise and informative result, which states that if zero is not an eigenvalue of t, meaning that t is an injective operator, then the inverse operator of t defined on the range of t is always an unbounded operator. While zero is always in the spectrum, there are no restrictions on the type of this spectral point. It can belong to any of the three parts of the spectrum, and it is even possible that it is the only point of the spectrum without being an eigenvalue. And as our last main result, we arrive at a very complete description of the spectrum of a compact operator outside the origin of the complex plane. This result states that any non-zero value lambda is either in the resolvent set of T, or otherwise it is an eigenvalue of T with a finite number of linearly independent eigenvectors. In addition, spectral points outside the origin can only have an accumulation point at zero. And a couple of highlights of the several consequences of this result are that for a non-zero lambda, the operator lambda I minus t is boundedly invertible whenever it is injective. And the operator t can have residual spectrum or continuous spectrum only at the origin of the complex plane. This result indeed holds for compact operators on Banach spaces and even on normed spaces which are not complete. On this course, we will only present the proof in a special case where X is a Hilbert space and the operator T is self-adjoint. In this case, we can shorten the proof a bit, especially since we already know that the residual spectrum of a self-adjoint operator is always empty. The description of the spectrum of a compact operator leads directly to a result which is known as the Fredholm alternative, named after the Swedish mathematician. This result states that for the linear equation lambda I minus t x equal to y with a non-zero complex number lambda, precisely one of the two alternatives hold. Either the equation has a unique solution for every right-hand side vector y, so that the solution is also continuously dependent on y, or otherwise the homogeneous equation lambda I minus t zeta equal to zero has a non-zero solution zeta. In the latter case, we can in addition say that the number of linearly independent solutions of the homogeneous equation is finite. And if X is a Hilbert space, then the linear equation has a solution for a given right-hand side vector Y, if and only if Y is orthogonal with respect to all of these solutions zeta of the homogeneous equation. Finally, every solution x of the linear equation can be obtained as a sum of a single solution of the equation plus a solution zeta of the homogeneous equation. In particular, this means that also the original equation has the same finite number of linearly independent solutions as the homogeneous equation whenever y is such that the solution exists. The most classical application of the Fredholm alternative, and also the point of origin for a lot of the theory on compact operators, is the case of Fredholm integral equations. These integral equations can be written precisely in the form of our linear equation lambda I minus t is equal to x, with the compact integral operator t and a non-zero complex number lambda, which is exactly the 1 over mu. The Fredholm alternative will then allow us to characterize the complex values mu and the functions g for which the integral equation has a solution. As we saw on the previous slide, the existence of the solutions of our linear equation is determined by the solvability of the corresponding homogeneous equation, which in the case of the integral operator takes the form shown here with the unknown function h. If mu is such that this equation does not have any non-zero solutions, then the solution f of the integral equation exists for any right-hand side vector g from the space L2. And on the other hand, if non-zero solutions of the homogeneous equation exist, then the equation has a solution precisely if the L2 inner product between the function g and all of the solutions h of the homogeneous equation are exactly equal to zero.